Hello, everybody, and welcome to Acoustic Analysis. On today's episode, we're going to delve into and analyze the crap out of George Harrison's great classic, Give Me Love. We're going to talk about how to play the song. We're going to look into and analyze it throughout who wrote it, who produced it, who played on the original track. Why is this song by George a classic, and why is it important both in terms of when it came out and now? And what does it all mean, Basil? I'm going to look at the deep, deep lyrics, and in this case, quite deep lyrical meaning behind George's song. And last but not least, I'm going to take a stab at playing through the whole thing, so don't go away.
It's Acoustic Analysis.
Okay, first up, how do you play George Harrison's Give Me Love? The song itself is technically in the key of F, but because we're talking acoustic guitars here, we're going to look at how George actually played it, and he played it with a capo on the third fret of the neck. The reason for that is that's where the voicings sounded best for it, and he's doing a D chord for the major riff in it. Just a D chord, but if you did it in F, you wouldn't be able to do these beautiful voicings as easily. So first off is just a D major, and then we're going to do a D major 7, followed by a straight good old D7, and then a G. So that's your major intro riff that's repeated throughout the song quite a few times. And anyone who's played guitar knows that that little riff when you're playing a D chord is really quite easy, and it sounds fantastic. It's used all the time. There's a reason for it. So if we put it all together with the pinky pull on, pull off, we've got a D to start with, D major 7, then we're going to D7, then G. So that's that main part. And then we go to an E minor, and then an A7. And you sort of pull on and off with your one finger. That's basically just an A7 chord. So then the verse. Let's do the verse. It's D, D major 7, E minor, A7, G minor, A7, then C, G, back to D, D major 7, E minor, A7, G minor, A7, C, and then back to the intro. And that's basically the whole song. It's extremely repetitive in the way that it goes through the lyrics and the different parts of the song. But at that point, he also introduced his amazing slide guitar riff, that little one. Except he plays it on slide. It's amazing, but we're not going to get into that. We're just going to, because I don't have anyone to accompany me, we're just going to stick strictly to the rhythm part for this exercise. Okay, so that's the nuts and bolts of how you actually play the song. If you want to go through it with me again, do it. Just rewind, do it again. Rewind, do it again. Rewind, do it again. Next up, let's look at who wrote and produced this song. It's a George Harrison composition. There's certainly no co-writer that is quoted on it, but it is strictly a George Harrison composition from, I'm going to say, 1971 or 72. We know it was recorded in the fall of 1972 at George's home studio in Tittenhurst? Something like that. I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but it's in England. And then he went into the studio to do overdubs in the fall of 73, January, February, into Apple Studios. Being a former Beatle, he had full access into Apple's facilities, so he took advantage and did some backing vocal tracks, and he did that aforementioned slide line, the melody line that, in my opinion, is one of the things that really makes the song stand out. The song was supposed to be produced by Phil Spector. Phil Spector was working, if you'll remember, back with the Beatles for their, I believe, their last two albums, Let It Be and Abbey Road. I'd have to look it up to be sure. But it was that wall of sound thing that they were so enamored with and in awe of back then. It's basically something that's kind of controversial at this point. I remember seeing an interview with George Harrison himself saying that he would almost prefer the songs to be more scaled down and acoustified rather than have the big wall of sound thing in hindsight. But at the time, it was the in thing to do. Here's what happened for this album, though. He produced, Phil Spector, produced the first album for George. And he was actually hired to do this one, too. And he never showed up. So George, the Beatles had an incredible work ethic. That's why they were so successful, or a big part of it. And George, after a few times of having a no-show Phil Spector, decided to move on without him and just go ahead and produce the darn track himself, which is exactly what he did. And he did a fantastic job. It got more to the very acoustic sounding. I mean, the song itself is, it starts off with this riff, and it's just an acoustic guitar, basically. He adds to it with some instrumentation as the song goes on, and it does a slow build. It's beautifully done, really tasteful, and it still sounds good today, in my opinion. Now, as far as musicians on this track, some interesting stuff, for sure. Klaus Voormann. He was part of the Plastic Ono band with John Lennon. He played on first several big albums by Ringo Starr, and he played on several, the first album and on this one with George Harrison. He even played with the Beatles back in the day off and on because they met him in Hamburg. You see, Klaus was German, and they met. He was a graphic artist and a musician. He played in his own band, played bass. And that's kind of overlooked, his bass playing capabilities. They always talk about him winning his Grammy for doing the cover of Revolver and being involved in all of the graphic and art world. And amazing talent, no doubt. But what a bass player! Beautiful, tasty stuff in this song. If you listen to the bass, it's gorgeous. Paul never used him because Paul's not a bad bass player himself. But George had him on bass, as did the rest of the Beatles, for most of their tracks back in the 70s. And he did a terrific job, in my opinion. So that's Klaus Voormann. That's the history from Hamburg. I mean, the Beatle guys knew him for, God, 20 years they worked with him. He was almost like a fifth Beatle. Of course, George Martin and Billy Preston might argue with that. So, that is the basics analysis of who wrote and produced and when it was recorded. The thing was released in May of 1973. On now to why this song is important. At the time, and still to this day, obviously, because the Beatles don't exist anymore, it was the only time in history that two Beatles were vying for the number one spot on the American Billboard. And Paul McCartney had it with My Love. This song by George Harrison came and took over the number one. So we had a number one with George and a number two with Paul McCartney. Two Beatles holding number one and number two spots in 1973 for their solo efforts. But it gets deeper than that. I mentioned the fifth Beatle argument. Billy Preston, who played on studio recordings and live on the rooftop Abbey Road thing with Get Back, he had the third. He had number three with Will It Go Round in a Circle. Same time. So we had a 1-2-3 Beatle solo project thing going on all at the same time. So that makes it very historically important. I would say another historically important thing about this song is and why it's gone on for so long and sounds good today is that it's like a prayer. And I think that's how George wrote it. I think he wrote it as a prayer. And as with My Sweet Lord before it, it's a gospel. It's like a Indian meets gospel influence. His Hindu religion that he was right into, along with all of his rock and roll and gospel American style roots, put together. And these two songs are basically My Sweet Lord and Give Me Love. Oh, do they? They're just like two peas in a pod, those songs. They go beautifully together. So, as for what does it all mean, Basil? What does this song mean? What is it all about exactly? It's a prayer. He's in a tough spot back in 1971-72. He's putting together the concert in Bangladesh for all of the starvation and awful living conditions that were going on there. He put a star-studded lineup together, but had tons of red tape trying to put it all together. Nothing but roadblocks, one after the other. And I think he was very frustrated through all of that. He also, very famously, had some marriage problems. Patty Harrison was being courted by his George's good friend Eric Clapton, who eventually won her hand. So there was a whole love triangle going on at the same time. And as far as I could see, Eric and George remained friends throughout. And Patty, it's a weird thing out of some kind of a movie. But that was the truth of it. It was a love triangle, beginning to end. So that's what the whole thing mean. It was like a mantra. It was like a prayer asking the Lord for help. And I think that's part of the reason of why, if you were to repeat this song for half an hour, just playing it over and over and to no end, it would feel very therapeutic, almost like meditation. So, without further ado, we're going to try to do a run-through of the song for you. Geek time. What guitar am I playing today? Today I'm on a 1959 Gibson J200 acoustic guitar, one of only 87 produced that year because they were so darn expensive when they came in and still are today, but totally worth it. I love this thing. This is my precious for sure. So let's give it a shot. Everybody for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any suggestions for other songs that you'd like to see reviewed on Acoustic Analysis, make sure you make a comment in the comments section and I'll try to get to it. Other than that, if you feel so inclined, share, subscribe, and like. I don't mind. if you don't. That's it for today, and thanks again. We'll see you next time.
It's Acoustic Analysis.